Good afternoon and welcome to today's session, AHA, that is Ask Him Anything with Mr. Vishal Shah. I am Prasanna, co-host of the event today. It's a very unique webinar concept, specially designed for enterprise owners and senior IT professionals. In today's session, we will focus on saving the cost that every enterprise spend on Microsoft license, email systems, and cloud backup. Let me introduce today's presenter, Mr. Vishal Shah, who is CEO and co-founder of Synersoft Technologies. He has over 18 years of experience and expertise in IT industry. He is also known as seasoned technology stalwart and inventor of specific patented technologies, a writer, a serial entrepreneur, an investor, and most importantly, a go-to guy for MSMEs. We also have Mr. Sudhir Chaubey, co-founder of Synersoft in the panel. He looks after the sales and marketing aspect of our organization. Vishal sir, can you please take it forward from here?
Yeah, thanks, Prasanna. Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. And thank you for attending this webinar. As always, you know, now this is the fourth webinar we are doing, and we are encouraged by the responses. I thank all of you to post your questions. We have compiled the questions, and we have, after compiling this particular questions, we have prepared this presentation. So we are going to have some very, very practical points to be discussed today. And they will be revolving around Microsoft license cost saving or email service license cost saving or cloud backup subscription cost saving. So I will try my best to help you with you know, all these legitimate and very, very logical strategies by which you can save the cost and you can do it very, very legitimately. So this is how we have planned this session. First of all, we will look at the Microsoft licensing cost saving part in order to understand that we will understand what are the kinds of Microsoft components we use in our day-to-day enterprise operations. And then we will zero down to each and every component. And after zeroing down to each and every component, we will make sure that we will see what are the alternatives. And then we will see how these alternatives can save the cost and to what extent this cost can be saved. And then we have also prepared one demonstration in which we have used all those tools, which are alternative to Microsoft licensing, and we would like to show you how easy they are to use and how you know how good they are while serving the purpose, and so that you can convince yourself that yes, you can save the cost without really compromising on the way users work or you know, the way an enterprise operates. Then in email services, we will see what are the current options available in email systems and email subscription services. And then we will discuss some very important point about the usability of email system and requirement of the users. And then we will see what are the alternatives. We will see how technically it is possible. And then we'll show you a demonstration how you can save the cost of email service without compromising with the security as well as the quality of the services. Third, we will look at the cloud backup services. We all require off-premise backup because we want to provide for disaster. We want to provide for data loss due to laptop loss of laptop or hardware crash. So we all want to you know, adopt cloud backup, but there are certain issues, challenges, and cost factors which are not really convincing. So we will see that how we can save the cost as well as how we can make sure that you know, the cost is very, very reasonable and we are able to serve the purpose of off-premise backup. So this is how we have planned this entire demonstration. And before I start with the Microsoft licensing cost, you know, I would like to run a poll just to identify, you know, the audience, you know, just to know who are there in the audience or which segment of industry or which segment of organization's role they are representing. So I request Prasanna to start a poll for 1 minute and then we would start the session. So as I see here, 15% of the attendees represent enterprise leaders aiming at cost saving. 56% of the attendees represent the role of IT manager aiming at cost saving. 7% are the consultants advising SMEs on IT investment. And 22% are representing the segment which is IT product and solutions supplier. So I think all the attendees are of very, very relevant, background. So, I think we have, amazingly, relevant audience. So now we will start our session. So let us first understand how do we use Microsoft licensing basically. So we use Microsoft licensing in different tools, in different software. And I have listed all these licenses over here on the screen. And I would like to explain what are these and what is the purpose of this. So normally we put Windows 2019 server for the purpose of enterprise policies, Active Directory and domain controls. We want to use Windows 2019 server as a file server. Sometimes we want to use Windows 2019 server as a terminal server for remote desktop login of our remote users. And many a times our software suppliers like ERP suppliers or CRM suppliers, they require us to invest in Windows 2019 server as a application hosting server. So when we use Windows 19 Microsoft server, the costs involved are server hardware, storage hardware, server license, client access license, and if it is being used as a terminal server license or RDP server, it also requires RDP CALS. This is remote desktop client access licenses. Apart from that, many of the applications which are developed in .NET framework or earlier versions of Microsoft development, software development environment, it requires SQL server. And when we want to have a SQL server, it is also a licensed product of the Microsoft and it requires either device CAL or it requires processor CAL. CAL is client access license. Most of us use Windows-based computer system, which requires Windows 10 professional OS. If we want to connect it with the domain, if we want to provide Windows environment to the user, and if we want to install the software which are dependent on Windows, like Tally, ERP, SAP, our users are mostly conversant with Windows operating system, and that's why we require Windows 10 operating system. So licensing cost of Windows 10 operating system is also what we pay for. And then the fourth one is MS Office. It is for our own productivity. We use MS Office for Word, for documentation, Excel for calculations, PowerPoint for presentations, and Outlook for our email organization, email management. And sometimes we use Microsoft Access, where we want to have some small applications and we use database access of Microsoft Access. And for that purpose, we also pay licensing cost. So this is what is always present in our IT infrastructure, and we are supposed to pay for it. So now today we are going to estimate the cost of all these things. We are going to estimate the cost of all these things, and basically we will actually understand each and every cost component, and then we will see where is the potential to save the cost, and then we will see how we can save the cost, and we will demonstrate, you know, we have made or we have created an ideal system where we can demonstrate that. So let us first understand the cost involvement in all these you know, Microsoft licensing things actually. So basically, before that, let me ask Prasanna to launch the poll, so I can enhance my understanding about, you know, your understanding on whatever I've told, and really you subscribe to that. So here we are able to see that 94% of the people agree to the fact that software license cost is significantly higher than the hardware cost. And 94% of the people agree that if we can minimize the software licensing cost, it can incredibly increase the ROI on IT spending. Okay, so next slide is going to be very, very relevant. So let us understand what is the cost we are incurring on Microsoft licensing basically. So when we talk about Windows 2019 server, which will include Active Directory, domain controller, enterprise policies, and data sharing for file server, this is the first part I'm talking about. So let me just, for your assistance, let me just highlight that part. One moment. So I'm going to discuss about this entire part, where if we want to have a complete enterprise environment with Windows 2019 environment, then first of all, we require to spend on server hardware. And server hardware, I mean, I've taken 25 user as a model network. So server hardware would cost approximately 4,000 rupees per user, means a 1 lakh rupees server will be required to, for next 5 years in case you are planning the investment. So it is 4,000 rupees per year. Then Windows server license and client access licenses, means client access license we have to pay per user or per device, and Windows server license we have to pay per server. So in combination, if we have 25 users model network, it is approximately 7,500 rupees per user. When we talk about the storage hardware, when we put a file server, we require good storage, and that storage hardware would be approximately 6,000 rupees per user in case we want to have good storage. But of course, it depends on how much storage you want to provide for your users. If your company is into AutoCAD, 3D Studio, you require a larger storage. If not, you require a smaller storage. But storage hardware, any NAS device would cost that much. Then we have to pay 14,000 rupees per you know, user for the operating system part. So these are, when we want to have a such an environment, Active Directory environment, almost 31,500 rupees we spend when we invest in a server hardware, we invest in the server software, we invest in client access license, we invest in storage hardware, we invest in operating system license. And when we divide it for the number of users for which this infrastructure is created, that cost comes to around 31,500 rupees per user. Then remote access license, in case you want to provide for work from home kind of environment and you would like to have remote desktop of your applications to your users, you might have to invest in terminal server hardware and software, and that would cost you 7,000 rupees. You cannot keep terminal server hardware and domain controller as same because terminal server hardware requires a lot of resources. So 7,000 rupees per user could be that cost of terminal server hardware. It requires huge RAM and processor, everything, when lot of users are taking remote connections together. And if you want to provide remote access, you also pay for terminal CALS, means RDP CALS. That would be around 6,500 rupees per user. So in case you want to provide for, you want to provide for something for the remote access, work from home, for whatever number of users you are providing for, that would be around 16,500 rupees per user. If you want to secure this remote access, you might have to provide for VPN license and hardware, and that might cost you 3,000 rupees per user. It could be some firewall or it could be some router, and the VPN license it provides, it is per user basis. Then in case you are hosting any application server and database, then you need to provide for a database server, which is hardware would cost 6,000 rupees per user, depending on number of users. And of course you will have to buy SQL server license, and that would cost you approximately 10,000 rupees per user. If you are opting for device CAL, if you are opting for processor CAL, it is more expensive. So for application database server, hardware, software, and client access license would cost 17,000 per user. And for the productivity, you have two options. One, you either buy Microsoft Office suite, which is 30,000 rupees per user approximately, and or you can subscribe to O365, which is 7,000 rupees per user per year. So it is 7,000 rupees per user per year. So in both the ways, we can find out that is recurring cost. The one is the one-time cost. So after having understood this, let us understand what kind of cost benefit it can give. We are suggesting that this entire part, this Active Directory, domain controller, enterprise policies, and data sharing can be done by a non-Microsoft file server and device hardening endpoint tools. So there are device hardening endpoint tools in the market, which you can deploy, which can eliminate the requirement of the server hardware, requirement of the Microsoft server license for creating domain and for propagating enterprise policies. And it will also eliminate the storage requirement for the file services. So device hardening and non-Microsoft based file server, if they are combined, they can be very easily deployed, and you can achieve the same sort of objectives of enterprise IT, and you can save good cost. Similarly, for remote access, we will see all these things in detail. Remote access, you can avoid using terminal server and terminal CALS. You can opt for application virtualization. So application virtualization is something where your application is virtually loaded on the remote computer, and the mouse click and keyboard strokes are transmitted across between the remote user and your application virtualization software, and only monitor output is transmitted across from your virtualization hardware to the user's computers. So that is how you can achieve the same objective of terminal services, and you can allow users to access your applications without spending on terminal server hardware and RDP CAL license. For SQL server, you can have other ideas which I'm going to share with you. And for productivity, Microsoft Word, Excel, I'm also going to show you something which you can see. Now we are going to the what kind of cost we can save on this particular entire module. So let us see that one moment. So now let us visualize the same requirements. Let us visualize the same requirements. First of all, we will see these requirements: application server database and SQL server, and then productivity, these two things. So first of all, when we are talking about application server database, you should be knowing about SQL Server Express Edition. This is SQL Server Express Edition, and this is very, very useful thing. You know, most of the times we do not use it. Now, this SQL Server Express Edition is a full-fledged SQL Server, which is limited by the RAM it utilizes, and it can be used only for the limited purpose or limited resources. When we are talking about 25 user network or 50 user network or 10 user network, you actually can very well run your application on the Express Edition. And SQL Express Edition does not require Windows Server license. It can installed on, it can be installed on a normal Windows 10 system. Now, one would argue that, you know, our ERP is having large data, and SQL Express license might not be sufficient for that. So for that purpose, I would like to share this idea. This is called workstation hardware with split database. So most of the times what I have seen is that all the ERP data of 5 years, 10 years, 15 years is there in the same database. So what you can do is, with your ERP service provider, you can tell them that if they want to use SQL Server, every year the database is changed. So let's say financial year changes, the database is added and database is changed. And that is how your working database size will be limited, and it will be less than 14 GB. Probably that is something which is allowed by SQL Express Edition license. And every time you are querying the database, that particular database will be small, so that you do not require a lot of resources, and SQL Express Edition license can very easily work on that. So this is a very, very smart tool. You can use SQL Express Edition. Because you use SQL Express Edition, your hardware requirement is not server hardware requirement. You can have a very good server grade workstation, load it with Windows 10, and that would not cost you more than 2,000 rupees per year, per user. And this particular Express Edition is free of cost. So instead of spending 17,000 rupees per user, you are spending 2,000 rupees per user. And maybe you can customize your URP such that every year a new database is created, and whenever you are querying the old year's data, you have an option to select the database, and then from that database, that is particular queries run, and you get the reports. And whenever you are working on your current database, it is always small enough because it is created new and only one financial year data is stored. So this is something which is answering a lot of your questions, where how you can minimize on SQL Server license cost. I have seen so many organizations who have benefited from this particular strategy. Now about productivity part, I would suggest everybody evaluates this WPS Office. You know, this WPS Office is a very good tool, which is compared to MS Office. It is having almost same, or I would say identical interface. So your users do not have to learn anything new in order to use Word, Excel, PowerPoint. Also, it has a default option to save it in DocX or in Doc. So in case somebody is sending the file from MS Office to your users, there won't be any compatibility issue. And when your user is sending some file to somebody who is using MS Office, there won't be any compatible issue. And about the Outlook, you can very well evaluate Thunderbird. Thunderbird is a very, very reputed email client. It is developed by Mozilla. And this is a very good email client, and it has fantastic features, and it matches with all the features of most of the features of the Outlook. And you can very easily make sure that, you know, you can migrate yourself from Outlook to Thunderbird and save a lot of licensing cost. So here, from spending 30,000 rupees per year, you might, you know, have no cost to bear, you know, if you adopt WPS Office and Thunderbird. Or you can deliberate that in case you want, you can have, let's say, 25 user network. two or three MS Office license or Outlook licenses can be given to certain users, and rest of the users can use WPS Office or Thunderbird. So this is how you can very well save a licensing cost, you know. So here we have seen that this 17,000 rupees cost is reduced to 2,000 rupees cost. And here this 30,000 rupees per user cost or 7,000 rupees per user per year cost is basically reduced to no cost. Now we will focus on this particular infrastructure. Now I told about we can very well do this by a very good file server and non-Microsoft file server and device hardening tool. So you can have a device hardening tool, whatever device hardening tool you want. You can search Google and you will find plenty. Blackbox is one of them. Storage hardware, which is going to be a Blackbox or any storage hardware. And now once you adopt this and when you get rid of the domain environment, you can use a non-pro operating system, means preloaded operating systems which are coming with the hardware, and that doesn't cost more than 4,500 rupees. And how we have derived this cost is when you look at the same configuration hardware preloaded with Windows and without loaded with Windows, the cost is hardly 3,000 to 5,000 rupees difference. So what you are paying actually is for preloaded operating system, which is not a pro operating system. But pro operating system is required when you want to connect your operating system to your user to a Microsoft domain environment. But when you create a domain environment by device hardening and you have a file server through some NAS device or a storage device, you can very well save this cost. So this 31,500 rupees per user cost can be saved to 16,500 rupees per user cost. It includes the server hardware, it includes the storage hardware, everything. So we have created one such profile without using anything of Microsoft, and we would like to show you how it works. And then we will also look at the remote access. You don't need to actually use terminal server if you want to save cost. There you can search Google with application virtualization software, and you can buy that application virtualization software. Blackbox AAA is one of the application virtualization software, and by that this 16,500 rupees per user cost can be saved to 8,000 rupees per user cost. So now we will see that entire profile which we have created without using any Microsoft. So this is how you have almost saved 15,000 over here. You have almost saved 8,500 over here. You have almost saved 15,000 rupees over here and 30,000 rupees over here. So per user, your entire saving is approximately 55,000 rupees, which is a big amount. Now we will see how we can have non-Microsoft things and we can have the same kind of output. So I request my technical team to connect to the Blackbox environment, and we will see how it works. And before that, I would like to request Prasanna to launch the poll, please. Yeah, meanwhile, please connect to the console system for device hardening. Yeah, so now if we see this, 97% of the people, have found practical and useful. Whatever ideas I have explained, they have found it practical and useful. So now we will see how device hardening can help you eliminate all these costs. So yeah, can we open the desktop, please? So this is a device hardening. You know, I'm not demonstrating black box, but I just want to give you an idea. Device hardening is something which is achieved by the installing a software agent. So whenever a software agent is installed, we get all those agents on the device hardening server, and then we can make the policy. Can we just go to account executive for which we are going to do this demonstration? Edit. So here, first of all, in device hardening, we decide that which computer system this particular user will work. So you can allow one system to work, to allow one user to work on multiple systems, or you can allow multiple users to work on single system. Then device hardening will define what kind of folders and files this particular user will be accessing from the server. Then device hardening will define which applications this particular user will access, just like we are defining in Active Directory services. So whatever applications we allow to the user, like Word, Excel, or Thunderbird, or Tally, only those applications can be accessed by the user. Then we can define whether this user will be the administrator or not. So here we can see if this user can be administrator, this user cannot be administrator. Then we will define in device hardening that whether this user can have access to local resources or not. And if we do not allow him to access local resource, he will be forced to save the data on the central location, which is a requirement, enterprise requirement of data centralization. So this is how device hardening happens. Now we will quickly log in to the accounts executive user, and we'll see how these policies are in effect. Now, remember, we are not using any Active Directory. We are not using any Windows domain. We are not using anything. We are using only Windows operating system, which is preloaded operating system on this particular computer. Now we will see that just for everyone's understanding, this device hardening means installation of the software agent. So you will see this software agent installed over here. Now we will see whether this user is the administrator of the system or not. So because we have done the device hardening, we have withdrawn the administrative right, and this user is not the administrator. Then we will see what is accessible to this particular user in the data. So now we see that all this particular user is withdrawn from administrative right, as well as we have not allowed him any local resources. So he's supposed to work on the file server. So this file server is a black box storage device, or you can have another file server also, any file server also. So I'm just talking about the device hardening. You know, this is what we do by Active Directory services. Without using it, you can also do this through this software agent based device hardening. And this user will be forced to work on these network folders. And that is how you can achieve the device hardening of the device hardening system. Now I would like to demonstrate the remote access part of it. So can we log into a laptop user who is not inside the local area network, please? So now we are logging into an account manager profile. It could be a laptop user, and we have hardened this particular laptop. We want to see how remotely he can access the application. So now I'm going to demonstrate something which is application virtualization software. So this application virtualization is done without use of terminal server, without using any RDP client access licenses, nothing. Now we will see that this particular user who is having access to this particular laptop does not have any installation done of the Tally client or any ERP client. And now we will see that here Blackbox AAA, you can have any application virtualization software. We are demonstrating Blackbox because we know Blackbox does that, but you can use any other application virtualization software also. This webinar is for saving the cost. How you save it? You can choose any product which suits your requirements. So we can double click on this application virtualization link, and immediately it will connect to the application virtualization server, which is not RDP server, terminal server, and we load Tally and ESSL kind of applications over here. We can click on Tally Prime, and Tally Prime will run. This Tally is virtualized. Tally client is not installed on this laptop. Only keyboard, mouse clicks and strokes are transmitted, and Tally's output is transmitted to this particular screen. So it can really work on low bandwidth, just like RDP or remote desktop applications work. So this is how you can access Tally. You can also access ESSL ERP also. Can you just please show fast? So this particular application is also loaded. This is also loaded outside of the network without any terminal server or RDP client. It is virtualized, and see the speed at which it is working. Very fast, because it is low bandwidth optimized application. So what I have demonstrated here, can you go to the browser based access, please? In case you don't want to install, or in case you want to access it through the browser, you want to have application virtualization inside in the browser, we can also do that in the browser. Just log into it by account executive or something. So this is a browser. This is application virtualization. We are doing it without any terminal server, RDP, anything. We can just click on Tally Prime. It will load in the browser. And user can work in the browser also in case he is using some other system. So this is how you can save a lot of cost by adopting device hardening, by adopting non-Microsoft based file server, and by adopting WPS Office, by adopting Thunderbird, and by adopting application virtualization instead of terminal server licenses. And that amount is almost, we have calculated, 50,000 rupees per user, which is extremely important, and it can really affect your return on investment. Yeah, thank you. So let me share my screen now, please. So now we will look at the Gmail part of it, you know, email service part. So see, let us understand what we use in Gmail or any other email service. So when we talk about, let us understand, when you are using email service or you are contracting email service for your organization, what are the components of that email service? So you have one email host, you know, means your domain has an MX record on the email host. So if you are using G Suite service, your domain has MX record of Google. If you are using O365 access, your domain will have MX record of O365. There are plenty of the service providers, good service providers, Netcore, Logix, so many people. So they all provide some email host which are ready to accept emails on your behalf and show it to the user in the mailbox. Then you also have one more component which is part of or bundled with your email system is SMTP relay. Means whenever you buy any email service, G Suite or O365 or Netcore or Logix, they will allow you to send email from your domain to the world. Then they are all equipped with anti-spam systems. So most of the times we have junk folder in our Outlook or in our Google interface or spam folder. So whatever emails they think, or they have some artificial intelligence. So whatever emails are categorized as spam, they are moved to the spam folder. So it is also anti-spam. Then there is antivirus also inbuilt in your email. Most of the times when you receive the emails, all these good service providers scan the emails with the virus. And if there is a virus, they actually remove the attachment. And then because they are competing with each other, they provide some other services also, like Google, along with its email system, it provides Google Drive. Along with its email system, it provides Google Meet or something else. So all these people provide some other service over and above plain vanilla email system. Now, I want you all to notice this and actually think about it very seriously. See, in every enterprise, there are two types of users, but only one type of email system, which is absolutely illogical. You know, if I have different types of email users, I should have different types of email system, and that is where we can save a lot of cost. I will first tell you what kind of users are there. One type of users are in office 10 to 6 kind of users. The users who go to the office, who check their emails, go home, then check their emails on the next day. And majority of the users, since SMEs are like that, and other users are anywhere 24/7 kind of users, anywhere access 24/7 users, like top management, salespeople, business development people. You know, they work all the day, all the night, all 24 hours, and they respond to their emails so quickly. So these are the two types of users. One type of user is in office 10 to 6 user. Another is, 24/7 anywhere kind of user. Now, what are the typical requirements of this kind of users? So these are the four typical requirements of this type of users. They require access on specific computer, means most of the times their computer is fixed. They require very basic email system, very, very basic email system. They want to send, receive emails, read their emails. Of course, they should be protected by anti-spam and antivirus on the email system because they are ignorant user and they should not be victim of any identity theft or email phishing. And they do not require very large mailbox, as emails are downloaded in their email client. Either they use Thunderbird or Outlook. They just download their emails. As soon as they download their emails, their mailbox is empty and those mails are downloaded. But actually, they do not require large mailboxes. So these are if an email system or email service provider can give these services to 10 to 6 office users, they are happy with that, and organization, you know, would agree that the requirements are solved. Now for 24/7 anywhere access users, they actually require anywhere access of the emails. They require large mailbox because most of the times they keep all their emails online. They check all their emails online. They require other services also, like Google Meet or Microsoft Meet or many other services which is provided by the email service provider. And they also require multi-device syncing. Means these people use iPad, these people use laptop, mobile phone, multiple devices. And they require access of their emails on all the multiple devices, which is not exactly true for the in-office 10 to 6 users. So we have two types of users. Actually, we have two types of users. And if we have two types of users, we should have two types of email system. We cannot keep paying, cost of 1,500 rupees to 3,500 rupees for all this feature for all the users, you know. So if there is anything in which you can pay premium for these people, you know, this anywhere access users, and you can save a lot of money on this particular user, there is a potential of cost savings. So let us understand how it works. So ask Prasanna to launch the poll, please, before we start how we save the cost. Yeah, so we can see this. I think 100% of the people agree that majority of the email users require no frills email system, and few users require all featured email system. So definitely there is a potential for cost saving. Now we will see how that cost can be saved. So let me explain it conceptually first, and then I will explain and show the cost saving. So let's say there is a, this is a, for example, a G Suite server, Google. And let's say you have so many users. In current situation, these are all mailboxes of these users. So everyone is getting all the features. Everyone is getting all the space, individual space, and everybody, whether he needs it or not, he gets all the features. Now, let us imagine this situation differently, and we call it DNS splitting technology. We'll see how it works. Let's imagine now there is another server, virtual server, which is called DNS splitting server. What it does, let us understand. So here in G Suite, we create one mailbox. Let me remove this. Now let us understand. Now let's say this is G Suite. These are all privileged users, means 24/7 users. And let's say there is one catch-all account. Catch-all account on the G Suite. Google has such a facility. And let's say we make one virtual server on cloud, which is DNS splitting server. What it will do, let us understand. And these are the users. Let us assume these are 10/6 users and these are 24/7 users. Now these users will directly fetch the emails from their mailbox. They will check the emails directly from their mailbox and we will incur full cost for them. But for 10/6 users, what it will do, this catch-all account will be fetched by this DNS splitting services. So here, let's say there are 100 users. These 100 users' mails will be there all together in this catch-all account. This DNS splitting server will access these emails of the catch-all account and split the emails user-wise. So let's say there are 100 users, and for 100 users, today 1,000 emails have landed in this catch-all account, let's say 10 each. Then those 10 emails per user will be split by this DNS splitting service, and it will distribute it to all the users. So these users, instead of directly connecting to G Suite service, they will connect to DNS splitting service and they will fetch their emails. And this user will get his emails, this user will get his emails, though all their emails are collectively landed here. Here, what they will do is they will connect to this DNS splitter, which has already split those emails according to the user-wise mailbox. And then these people can download the emails. So here you will spend only one account expense, and so many people can, you know, access the emails through this virtual server, which is having a mail distribution system by splitting the emails. Now what happens, this G Suite service is equipped with antivirus, anti-spam, SMTP relay, everything. So whenever the email is landing over here, or whenever the email is going out from here, it is going to be from the G Suite only, and these emails can be accessed through DNS splitting service. So this DNS splitter will download the emails and distribute it to a user, or if this user wants to send an email out, it will give it to the DNS splitter. DNS splitter will change the authentication over here, and then it will give it to this catch-all account, and then from catch-all account, G Suite will relay the email. So you will serve the purpose and you can minimize the cost drastically. We will see now how. So here, as I have explained, This is your email host. It could be Microsoft, it could be Google, whatever. This is your DNS splitting virtual server. It will download the emails from the catch-all account. And these are the remote laptops who are 24/7 users. They are directly accessing the emails from your email host. And these users who are 10-6 users are accessing the emails from the DNS splitter. So for them, the email is coming from the world to Google and from the Google to the DNS splitter and from DNS splitter to the 10-6 users. For these people, email is coming from the world to the Google or Microsoft, and then they are directly accessing it. Now, let's assume that 80% of the users are 10-6 users and 20% of the users are 24/7 users. 1,500 to 3,000 rupees kind of yearly cost. For 10-6 users, it would cost this much. And for 24/7 users, it would be costing this much. For 80 users, 1,500 rupees will be 1,20,000 rupees. For 80 users, 3,500 rupees would be 2,80,000 rupees. And if you have DNS splitter yearly cost, including virtual servers cost, that would cost you just 82,000 rupees. And here it is costing you 1,50,000 rupees to 3,50,000 rupees per year. And this is a yearly cost without compromising anything. What we are doing is we are cutting down the features for the users who are not using those features or who are not requiring those features. So we are not doing anything compromising in our email system. At the same time, we are not compromising with the security because again, anti-spam, antivirus, everything is already there on the host provider. And we can save this clean cost, you know, and that is how this can work. So this is about the cost saving potential in email service. Now we will move to the last part of this webinar, which is how we can save the cost on the cloud. So Prasanna, can you please launch the poll? Meanwhile, I request the technical team to show the MX records of Blackbox or Cinersoft. Yeah. So I think 91% of the people would like to explore this kind of idea. And why I am showing you this MX toolbox, I'm going to show you and I'm going to tell you that in Cinersoft, we have quite a good number of users and we are using this technology for last 4 years. And since 4 years, we have been saving huge number of cost. Can you please go to blackbox.in or cinersoft.in? Yeah, blackbox.in, MX lookup. So here, just check, any email which is landing on blackbox.in is actually going to the Google. So we are on G Suite, but majority of the users who are in our call center, who do not require their emails when they are outside of the call center for confidentiality purpose. We have kept them in our catch-all account. We have created one DNS server account and they can access their emails either to Thunderbird or webmail. Certain privileged users, like I am a privileged user and I can access my mails from directly Gmail. So this is how it works, and believe me, it works and it saves real hard cash cost. Okay, so now we will move to the last part of this webinar, which is how we can save the cloud backup cost. So I will share the slide for that. So now let us understand what are the cloud backup options. I'm not talking about the collaboration. I'm talking about the backup. Now this cloud backup means we want to keep the backup of the user's system or the certain folders on the user's system so that if user system is formatted or it is lost or hardware crash happens, we do not lose our data. And there are various options like Google Drive option, OneDrive option, Dropbox option. You can also purchase some endpoints, which are cloud backup endpoint. And you can have Amazon S3 kind of service for the storage. And you can also take the cloud backup. Now, there are various challenges pertaining to this, which is number one. It is per user per year cost. See, we are talking about enterprise backup, so it should not be per user per year cost. Then there is another problem, which is user's discretion to stop, pause, or backup. Means you can have a cloud backup client installed on user system, but if user will have all rights to stop the backup or pause the backup. We will see how. Then users will have all the rights to change the account settings also. Means user can even change the account settings such that the backup starts happening to his personal drive. Then it is user's liberty to save the data away from the map folders. Means you can define one folder in which user is supposed to work, and that will be backed up on the cloud. Now user starts working in the folder which is not that folder, which is not mapped with the cloud folder. And then your data is not actually backed up. And sometimes you want that entire hard drive of the user is backed up. In that case, it makes the system very slow because it has to scan entire hard drive. So what is the solution? And what is the potential of the cost saving? So now we will see. First of all, I would like to show you all these challenges. Okay. So we have installed some cloud backup solutions, and I'm going to show you how open it is and how it defeats the purpose. So I request the technical team to connect to the open this cloud backup client installed system. So now see, we have installed Google Drive, we have installed OneDrive also. I think OneDrive is also there. Now, first of all, I want to show you that you are going to pay per user per year. Okay. So for this user, you have to take 1 terabyte of OneDrive or 30 GB of Google Drive. For other user, you have to take 30 GB of Google Drive or 1 terabyte of OneDrive. It doesn't serve the purpose because your data is centralized. You might have designs, drawings, which are not scattered on user system. It might be there on your file server. So that is one thing where enterprise-wide cloud backup system should be there, not user-wise cloud backup system. It is very consumer kind of product. Another thing I stated was the user can pause or stop the backup. So here user can just right click on that and can pause the backup. Yeah, can you just right click and show? In the settings, he can pause the backup. See, he can pause the backup. Similarly, I explained that user can even stop the backup. So by pausing the backup, he can stop the backup also. Third thing I told that user can even change the folder settings, which folder you want to take the backup. So you can just right click here, you can add folder or you can remove the folder, whatever. And this is how whatever folder you want user to work in, he might work outside of that folder and backup does not happen. Or he might add few more folders for which you don't need to take the backup. And in case you want that entire hard drive of the user system is backed up, in that case, it slows down and a lot of junk data will also go to your cloud backup. So this is something which is very democratic. You know, here we are completely on the discretion of the user. See, here in OneDrive also, you can pause the syncing. Here in OneDrive also, you can go to the settings and you can add the account. See, now user can even change the account. You know, let's say you have your own OneDrive account, company's OneDrive account. User can just unlink this PC and user can just take out this PC from the backup purview, or user can add his own personal OneDrive account, and all your enterprise data, which could be confidential data, will go to his personal data, and your purpose of backing up the data will not be served. So this is something which is very scary. Though you pay huge amount on per user per year, you need something which is robust, which is not absolutely under the user's control, and it is in the control of the enterprise, because it is enterprise's data and it is owned by the enterprise, and enterprise has to make sure that its data is not leaked or stolen, or its data is properly backed up. Now we will see a hardened profile. Log on to some profile, hardened profile. Go to account manager profile. So now we will see the hardened profile where per enterprise kind of backup system should be there. So here, if you see, this endpoint is installed over here. Just see this endpoint. This endpoint is installed. Now this endpoint, even if he right clicks on that, he does not have any options to change the settings. Just right click on that. So he can only have change password and some other applications, but he cannot really make the change or stop the backup. Means this endpoint is installed, the backup is bound to happen. Now go to my computer. Now this computer is hardened such that user cannot work on any other folder other than this folder, which is mapped with the cloud backup. So only these two folders are mapped with the cloud backup, and only user can work in these folders only. He can make then n number of subfolders, but he can work only in this particular folder, nowhere else. So what happens here is that we are also, by hardening, we are also overcoming that limitation that user can stop the backup, user cannot. User can change the folder settings, user cannot. User can save data outside of the folder which is mapped on cloud backup, user cannot. So this is how we can harden the device, and you can make sure that backup happens for sure. And we are not paying per user per year, we are paying enterprise level. So let's say you can have 2 terabyte or 4 terabyte or 8 terabyte of cloud backup, and all your users of 100 computers, 50 computers, 25 computers, all their data goes to one place without user's intervention to be able to stop the backup or change the settings, or maybe change the destination where the backup is happening. So this is something which is very important to know, and we wanted to show it to all of you. And now we will see how much cost it can save. So, before I go to the cost part, let me explain. See, there has to be a control system also, whether the backup is happening. The enterprise owner or enterprise manager should know that backup is happening in this OneDrive or Google Drive or any kind of systems, which are very basic systems. They do not really give you such reports in a very, very centralized manner. Here, you can also, with device hardening and enterprise cloud backup system, you can have multiple reports. So let us see that report also, and then I will move to the cost part. Subhadip, can you show the dashboard of the report? No, you need to close the window and because the captcha was stale, basically. The captcha was stale, yeah. See, now let's say we want to see this. This is enterprise backup, 4 terabyte, 8 terabyte, 12 terabyte, on which all the users backups are happening. So let's say we go to DCDR, we'll be able to see this complete, backup. There are 15 laptops which were backed up. It was successful or it was an error. Let's say we go to some laptop. Can you go to some other laptop, please? Prasanna DV incomplete means it is happening, so we can see this. What is the data over here? Can you go down, please? Yeah, total data size. No, Prasanna's laptop. Yeah, go down. So 3.8 GB, it is under process, but there was some error. So we would know about this particular error, and we would know about this error, and we can take the actions. So even most of the times when we do it on Google Drive or OneDrive or any such email backup, you do not give it any visibility. So this gives us complete visibility. Now go to the server side backup. So here we can go to that hard disk wala backup. Yeah. So let's say if we have kept the backup of the server, can you go in the first serial number one? So 750 MB was copied, 534 files were copied, 19.97 GB of the backup was stored on the cloud. So all this visibility is necessary at the enterprise level. Now we will see the cost part of it. So I will share the presentation again. So now if we look at the cost part, all these traditional backup for 25 users, and we have taken the cost of 5 years, total 5 years cost for your cloud backup, that will have a recurring cost of 3,75,000 rupees to 5 lakhs of rupees of the agent cost, and we'll have 2,07,000 rupees of a 2 terabyte of the cloud backup, you know, enterprise cloud backup. So the pricing is here, 3,000 INR to 4,000 INR for cloud backup endpoint, and 0.023 US dollar per GB, which is a very reasonable rate for an enterprise cloud backup, 0.023 USD, that costs 2,07,000 rupees for 2 terabyte. And this is how it comes to around 5,82,000 rupees to 7,07,000 rupees per year. And for 5 years, I'm saying, if you go for this kind of device hardening, for device hardening, you can go for INR 75,000 for the agent cost. And this can be 3,25,000 rupees of the recurring cost. So that goes down to 4 lakhs of rupees for entire 5 years. Here you can protect, you are protecting all your data from disaster, flood, fire, hardware crash, or loss of laptop. And in this particular amount, you can save almost 50% of the cost, or maybe 40% of the cost. So this is about, you know, knowing about how you can save the cost. And I think we have covered all the questions which are submitted during the poll, or during the AHA registration. Yeah, Prasanna, can we have a last poll, please? Yeah, so now we can see that 67% of the people agree that user can stop, pause the backup and defeat the purpose. 33% people agree that user can change the backup folder, destination folder on the cloud backup. 95% of the people agree that device hardening can solve this problem. Yes, it is. So I see some gentlemen raising the hand. So I would request, we are now entering to Q&A session. So you can write down your question in case you want to ask any question. You know, we can very well work on it basically. And I'll be able to answer it. Yeah. So any questions, please write down in the question answer session so we can answer those questions. Yeah, Mr. Lakhani, I request you to write it in the question answer session, a question answer tab, actually. You are writing it in the chat. I will of course answer this question, but better you answer you ask your question in question answer. Yeah, you have you are writing that we have managed service of AWS and it is expensive now. Yes, you are right, it is expensive. You can take very well. I think people are posting their questions in chat. Can you please do it in question answer? It is easy. It is more simpler to manage. I will answer those questions. Mr. Lakhani is saying we have managed service of AWS and it is expensive now. Yes, you can very well save the cost. You can offline share the requirements with your contact person in Synersoft, and we will definitely give you a idea how you can save the cost. And yes, we have so many people who have saved, we have so many customers who have saved this much of cost. Mr. Sharma is asking, can you please share the recording of this entire session? Yes, we are going to share, no problem. We are going to share this recording. Mr. Chintan is asking how this can be helpful for 3-4 user enterprise. Very easy. You can go for a cloud backup and you can have device hardening tool, which is just available in 5 user kind of package. You can have that and harden the device and get your backup happen. With minimum cost, you can take extra care of your data. And now let us see which are the questions. Yeah, so I think I answered this Mr. Lakhani's question live. Mr. Prashant is asking how much cost about 6 to 8 terabyte cloud data, about 35 to 40 users. It should not be more than, I would say, what, 35,000 per month, for these people. Mr. Prashant, you can connect with your representative for any commercial thing. I'm not very good at commercials, so they will definitely help you. Mr. Bakshi is asking, is DNS splitter is built-in feature in black box? DNS splitter is not a built-in feature in the black box. Black box has multiple models. So black box hardware is basically having DNS splitter technology, and you can add on to that. So mail distribution system, you can add if you are not buying the black box. So DNS splitter can be a independent product, and it is black box is not the only one who is providing it. There are so many DNS splitters available. So if you buy black box hardware, it is part of it. And if you don't buy black box hardware, you can also host DNS splitter on the virtual server through black box or through any other service provider. So we also provide a hosted DNS splitter. So you don't have to worry about providing virtual server for that. We provide hosted DNS splitter. So for that purpose, let's say if it is Google, then you pay, very frugal for that particular service. So for only the users who are privileged users or 24/7 users who require all those features, you can go for that part for the full payment, and then rest of the people can pay for a catch-all account and DNS splitter. It is possible. Yeah, so I think, one more question, one moment. DNS splitter, from where I can buy? Mr. Mistry, you can inquire with a sales representative of Synersoft. Prasanna can help you. In case you want to buy or evaluate other DNS splitters for comparison purpose, you can search the Google and you can search DNS splitter mail distribution system. DNS splitter mail distribution system. You will have plenty of the results and you can very easily find out the DNS splitter. And if you want black box DNS splitter, you can very well connect with Prasanna. She will help you out. Yeah, so I think we overshot this webinar by 18 minutes. One more question. Can the black box service be integrated with ERP and CRM data? No, black box is basically completely a different solution. It is data loss, leakage, and theft prevention solution. It has another product called Blackbox AAA, which is application virtualization software. So that application virtualization software can be integrated with your ERP and CRM, and that ERP and CRM can be accessed from anywhere or from the browser. If your ERP is not browser-based ERP, you can access that through application virtualization over the browser or over the application virtualization from remote places. Mr. Vader is asking, we use license version of Windows 7. Microsoft provide tools license version of Windows 7 converted to Windows 10. So can we use it? Yes, you can use it. Absolutely fine. You can use it, Mr. Vader. Does it support Linux Ubuntu platform? We discussed three different products. The first product was about Microsoft licensing device hardening. So that device hardening, if we talk about Blackbox, it does not support Ubuntu, but there are many other device hardening tools which support Ubuntu. Another product we discussed was Gmail, in which whether it is Ubuntu or whether it is Windows, it doesn't matter because you are downloading the emails in your email client or you are checking the emails from the browser. So second part, email service, it supports Ubuntu platform. And third is about cloud backup. So again, there are endpoints and device hardening required for making sure that user does not have much of the liberty. And for that purpose, Blackbox supports Windows only, but you can always inquire about the hardening and endpoint for the backup of Linux Ubuntu. But there are very few because Linux is not a commercial operating system. So people who are looking for free, you know, they look for this kind of options. So most of the service providers do not provide any commercial product on that. But yes, you can try it on Google. Yeah, so I think we can take one more question in next 2 minutes or we can wind up. We having Windows 7 license, but can Blackbox feature support Windows 7? See, this is a very, very tricky question. You know, you should not use Windows 7 license. You should immediately upgrade to Windows 10 because Windows 7 is no longer supported by Microsoft. So Windows 7 is now vulnerable because it is no longer patched by the Microsoft. So Blackbox supports Windows 7 or not is a second question. Of course, Blackbox supports Windows 7, but not as good as it supports Windows 10. Yeah, so we will conclude this session. Over to you, Prasanna.
Thank you, sir. That was very interactive and a wonderful session. We have Sudhir sir with us, so I would like him to conclude the session for us. Sudhir sir, can you please conclude the session?
Yes. Thank you, Prasanna. Dear participants, it was a wonderful session conducted by Mr. Vishal. And your attendance, your participation is giving us a lot of encouragement. And we will continue this endeavor in the near future also. With your valuable support, thanks to everyone. Thank you once again for participating and attending this session. We can conclude this session, Vishal bhai.
Yeah, thank you. And please help us by participating in the poll survey, which you will receive as soon as you close this session. It will help us in improving this particular content. Thank you so much. Thank you very much. It is so encouraging. And we feel so happy that, you know, this kind of cost saving ideas are, you make use of them and you save the cost and, contribute more to your business. Thank you very much. Thank you.